Well, good morning and welcome to Middletown Presbyterian Church on this fourth Sunday of Advent. Advent just seems to be moving along so quickly. some things to bring to your attention, believe it or not, since it's the fourth Sunday of Advent, that means that this week will be Christmas Eve and Christmas Day. So our Christmas Eve service will be at 8 p.m. On Christmas Eve. However, it will be all virtual, so I'll be sending out the link for that closer to the time, but keep that in mind. And if you're going to join us live, because hopefully I'll have the service recorded and uploaded shortly after we end Christmas Eve, so that if you aren't able to join us at 8, you can watch it a little later in the evening. But if you are going to join us live, I'd invite you to have a candle ready and with you so that we can do a sort of virtual candle lighting, and I'll explain that as we get to it that evening. But have a candle handy with you and something to light it with. That would be good too. also, following that, the Sunday after Christmas, which would be the 27th, we will also be virtual. I suspect that we will probably be virtual the first Sunday in January as well. We'll see how that goes. I'll let you know on the 27th. But the way things are going at the moment, I don't think the effects of the vaccine will have taken effect that quickly. So we will probably be virtual those two Sundays anyway, and we'll play it by ear from there. We do have giant gift cards available. If you would like a giant gift card, please contact Linda Fox, and she will make arrangements to have those delivered to you at a convenient time. Lastly, today, immediately following worship, we are going to have a brief congregational meeting because we have one more deacon to elect for service for next year and really for the next 3 years. So stick around afterwards, and we'll have that congregational meeting. Probably won't take very long, hopefully. And I think that is all of our announcements for this morning. So let us begin our worship with our call to worship. And you might all just be praying that the PowerPoint works this morning, because it has been very temperamental this morning for some reason. All right, Kent.
Please join me in the call to worship. Advent is a time for God's people to reawaken their longings.
Let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts.
Where there is division, we long for unity.
Let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts.
Where there is hostility, we long for resolution.
Let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts.
Where there is separation, we long for reunion.
Let the peace of Christ rule in our hearts. And this morning, we light the fourth candle of Advent as we look forward to the peace which is ours through Christ, whose birthday we are getting ready to celebrate. And so let us begin this morning singing his praises.
Hopes and fears of all the years You're still muted, Pastor Doug.
Thank you. Isaiah the prophet reminds us, the Lord longs to be gracious to you. Therefore, he will rise up to show you mercy to you. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all those who wait for him. So let us pray together the prayer of confession. It is Advent. It is the season in which we prepare our hearts to welcome Christ, who is the bringer of all peace. We confess to you the ways in which we block the peace of Christ in our lives, the rushing and scurrying to get things done, the worry about the little details, the financial burdens we put on ourselves, the impatience and irritability we feel and take out on one another, the bickering and quarreling we get into because we are too busy, we confess to you, O God of peace. Though we make ourselves less than peaceful at this time of the year, your peace is always there for us. Instill within us your peace, O God. Instill within us your peace and help us to make choices that bring us closer to you. Help us to be more peaceful so that we may spread Christ's peace and love to others. In Jesus' name. And so, as we sang just a few minutes ago, Christ, cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. And now, Bernadine Steinmetz is going to share with us again.
Oh, thank you. Good morning. I'm going to play a small part of Bach's cantata, Sleepers Awake. It's not a Christmas song, but it is a song of hope. The music is based on a hymn written in 1598 by a pastor, a Lutheran pastor named Philippe Nicolai, while his city of Unna, Germany was experiencing a terrible epidemic. He wrote the hymn to bring hope to his congregation. It is focused on Jesus Christ's return to his faithful followers and encourages each of us to hold up our lamps and share our light. Nicolai's light was his faith and his hope for a brighter future.
Thank you, Bernie.
You're welcome. Thank you.
And now we come to our Old Testament scripture for this morning.
This morning's reading is from the book of Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 6 and 7. For a child has been born for us, a son is given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Kent. And now let us sing together again.
Unexpected, would you believe after all we've projected, a child in a manger, lowly and small, the weakest of all, unlikeliest hero, wrapped in his mother's shawl, just a child, is this who we've waited for?
Let us pray together. Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for this new day to gather and to worship you as we move ever closer and closer to the day that we celebrate your coming to earth, your being born here as a small human baby. And Lord, we just pray that you would be present here among us this morning wherever we are, that you would, your spirit would be poured out on each one, on each household represented, that your spirit would be filling each one of us, filling our hearts and drawing our hearts close to your heart, and filling our minds and drawing our minds close to your mind, that we might become more and more made in your image. Lord, speak to us this morning, for your servants are listening. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Well, here we are, the fourth Sunday of Advent, and this morning we are celebrating peace, and it's interesting. I think we all really desire peace, peace in our hearts, peace in our lives, peace in our homes, and certainly peace in the world around us. And yet, as we prayed this morning in our prayer of confession, often a lot of the peace we fail to experience, we bring that on ourselves so often by just overcrowding our schedules, overspending our accounts. But there are also so many other ways that we tend to drive peace from us. Certainly, we have all experienced, and we've certainly seen throughout this last year, certainly racial tensions and all sorts of other tensions and political tensions. And the reality is that for some reason, we as human beings have a tendency to focus on our differences, to create groupings and to create us and them scenarios. However we create those, they could be based on race or skin color. They could be based on political views or ideas. They could be based upon certain areas that one lives or comes from. They could be based on fashion. Certainly growing up, you know, you always wanted to be wearing the cool stuff that everybody else was wearing. So we just create all of these things. And the church really is caught up in that as well. You know, we have so many different brands of Christianity. We have Catholic Christians and Episcopalian Christians and Lutheran Christians and Presbyterian Christians and Baptists, and then all of those non-denominational Christians. And that's just a few. I mean, even within the Presbyterian Church, we have a whole bunch of different kinds of Presbyterians. We create all of these barriers to one another. And our scripture this morning comes from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus, Ephesians, chapter 2, starting in verse 11. And the reality is these divisions are not a new thing. But back at the time that Paul was writing, and before, from a Jewish perspective, when people within Judaism looked at the world, there were really two categories of human beings. You were either Jewish, which meant that you were the chosen race. You were the nation that was chosen by God. You were the elect. You were the people that God loved specially. And if you were not Jewish, you were Gentile. Those were the only two categories. The whole world in the Jewish mind could be summed up as either Jewish or Gentile. And at the time, the Jews really did not see much point in trying to convert the rest of the world. They certainly didn't put a whole lot of energy into it. It was difficult enough for them to keep their own focus on the God who had chosen them. And so this is This is the mindset into which Paul is writing here. And so at verse 11, he says, "So then, remember that at one time, you Gentiles by birth, you who were born outside of Judaism, and so are therefore Gentile, you were called the uncircumcision by those, the Jews, who were called the circumcision." And this was a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands. "Remember that you were at that time without Christ." Now, that's sort of an interesting statement right there, because actually the Jews at that time were also without Christ, but we'll set that aside for now. "Being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For Jesus is our peace. In his flesh, he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall, that is, the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him, both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then, you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God." So, for whatever reason, we as humans have this tendency to build up these barriers, to build up these walls, to create hostility based on the way that somebody looks, based on what they may believe, based on where they're from, based on who they're related to, based on their gender or their gender identity or their sexual orientation or whatever it is. We create these barriers between us. We create these us and them. And certainly we've seen the political barriers seem to grow ever higher in recent years. And part of that, I mean, on the one hand, I think a lot of it has to do with blame. Whenever anything happens, we want somebody to blame for it. If the economy's bad, we want somebody to blame for it, because none of these things, I mean, if I'm out of work, that can't be my fault. It has to be somebody's fault. And so we pick people to blame it on. But also, we have this tendency, this need to be right. We are right. They are wrong. We are enlightened. They live in darkness. We are special. They are not so special. That's how we tend to look at it, because quite frankly, bottom line, it makes us, it helps us to feel better about ourselves if there's somebody else that we can look at and claim that we are better than. Now, am I saying that they are right and we are wrong? No, I'm not saying that. Am I saying we are right and they are wrong? I'm not saying that either. What I'm saying is that from God's perspective, we are all wrong. We think we're right, but the reality is, from God's perspective, we're missing it entirely. Jesus came, and Paul reminds us here, Jesus came to break down those barriers, to create one humanity. Because the reality is, there is not one of us who is better than the other. There is not one of us who is more righteous than the other. We are all wrong from God's perspective. And whenever we build ourselves up as right, whenever we look down on someone else, we are just proving right, and we are wrong. But the amazing thing is, despite all of that, God loves us. He wants better for us. He did not come to judge us because we're so wrong, even though we are. He came to save us from our wrongness. He came to show us that if we would just learn to love each other, to look past our differences and recognize our sameness, our humanness, our flawedness, to recognize our need for a savior, and to love each other toward that savior, we would know peace. You see, the Jewish concept of peace was not simply the absence of conflict. It certainly included the absence of conflict, but it was greater than that. It had to do with the oneness, with us being one body in Christ, with us being one mind with God, with us being at one. And here's the amazing thing. I mentioned this last week, the idea that the cross was not a mistake in terms of that being the method of execution that Jesus suffered. Because it has the vertical and the horizontal aspect, the loving God and loving one another. And the reality is that if there is me and there is you, whoever that me and you is, the I and the other, if we begin moving toward God, both of us, we also begin moving toward each other. When we begin listening to God, when we begin following his wisdom for life, when we understand his love for us and we begin to move toward him, we also begin to move toward each other. The top piece of the cross creates a triangle. The relationship between you and I, and the relationship between each of us and God. And as we move up the sides of that triangle, moving closer to God, we move closer to each other. And that was his intention. That he breaks down all of these barriers. And what have we done? We have created more barriers between us. In fact, the church really has become, in a way, the new Judaism, that we are the chosen ones, and those people out there are the Gentiles. And we don't necessarily want them joining us. But the fact is, Jesus came to break down those barriers. He came that we might love one another as he loves us, that we might not badger or force or cajole people into a relationship with God, but that we might love them into a relationship with God, that we might draw them close by love. And in that relationship, introduce them to the God who loves them, who wants more for them, who wants to bring them and us peace. Peace with God and peace with one another. But until we begin seeing each other as created and loved by God, just as we are, as long as we continue to create barriers between us and them, we will never truly know peace. We won't know peace in our own hearts. We won't know peace in our own homes. We won't know peace in our communities. And we certainly won't know peace in our world. The reality is, peace started with God. He came that you might know peace with him, that you might know forgiveness and love and mercy from the God who created you. But he wants each of us to be a starting point in creating peace in our own lives and homes and communities. That through us, peace might be established in this world. It seems like a big ticket item, and it certainly is, and we cannot do it without God's help. But that's the other amazing thing about this relationship, is he promises to fill us with his Holy Spirit, to empower us to do that which he's called us to do. He empowers us to love. He empowers us to see the world differently. He empowers us to see people differently and to love them, despite the fact that we might not always agree with them. We might not always be like them, nor they like us. But we are called to love them, that we all might know peace. That's why he came. That's why we celebrate his coming. We celebrate his birth. We talk particularly this time of year about peace on earth. But what are you willing to do to achieve that peace on earth? We need to begin seeing the world and the people around us differently. We need to be seeing what is the same in them. We need to be seeing their need of a Savior and our need of a Savior. The reality is, that really is the impetus for sharing our faith, is that we might begin to help people to move closer to God as we move closer to God, that we all might experience God's peace right here on earth as it is in heaven. Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks for this day. We give you thanks for your love for us, for this season that reminds us that you came, that you were born as a human infant, that you lived among us, that you experienced this life just as we do, that you lay down your life for our sins. Lord, we pray that you would be with us, that you would fill us with your Spirit, that you would empower us to love each other, to love all of the others as you have loved us. And Lord, as we gather today, we lift up some of those who are on our hearts and mind. And it seems we have an ever-growing list of both those who are dealing with cancer and those dealing with COVID. And Lord, we particularly just want to mention Hannah and Rich Hurst and another Rich whose leukemia has returned. And we continue to pray for baby Sophia and Betty Ann, who had surgery for thyroid cancer, and Rita, who's dealing with breast cancer, and another young mother who has been diagnosed with breast cancer, and then all of the others that we have been praying for it seems months now. And we lift them all to you, Lord, and we pray that you would be in each life and each situation, in each battle, and that you would bring whatever resources are needed, and Lord, that they would, each one would be strengthened for their battle, and Lord, that they would achieve healing. And Lord, we just ask your blessings on all of them, and we continue to lift up all those dealing with this virus, and just pray, Lord, that you would be in each life. We particularly lift up Joe Brower, who has COVID and pneumonia and has really been struggling with breathing. And Lord, we just lift him to you, and we lift all of those who are battling this virus, and just pray that you would be in each one, fill them, strengthen their bodies, help them to deal with whatever treatments are necessary. And Lord, we pray that you would bring them healing and hope. And we continue to lift up Emily Baker as we try to figure out some way of helping her with the symptoms she's been experiencing. And Lord, we just pray that you would guide her and give her healing. And for Cindy Abrams as well, who's been continuing to deal with some seizures, and just pray, Lord, that you would lead them to the right doctors and the right treatments that she might have some relief. We also want to lift the Baker family and the as well as the Simcox and Wren family as they mourn the passing of Kenneth, and we'll be celebrating his life this week. But Lord, we just pray that you would be in their midst and strengthen and encourage them and give them hope and just help them, Lord, as they prepare to celebrate Ken's life, and we ask your blessings on them. And Lord, we just continue to lift our nation and our world as we all deal with this pandemic, but not just the health issues, but all of the financial issues and the businesses that are struggling and the people who have been out of work. And Lord, especially as we approach Christmas, we just pray, Lord, that you would provide resources to all those who are in need. Lord, we just pray that these vaccines will help to bring this pandemic to an end. Lord, we just lift that whole situation to you, for we pray all these things in the mighty name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now we come to a time of offering. And again, we just give you thanks for your continuing financial support of our ministries here at Middletown. Encourage you to continue to send in your tithes and offerings to keep this place up and running, even when we can't all gather together, but in the hopes that in the very near future, we will once again be able to gather here in the sanctuary. And here is our slideshow, and I hope that this works, because this in particular is the piece that has been temperamental today. That's not it. There we go.
Into darkness comes a light, into silence a baby's cry, the birth of freedom, the death of fear, in a manger Christ is here. Let there be peace on earth.
Now let us sing one more time as we end our worship together.
Christian men, rejoice with hope. is born today.
Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye hear of endless bliss.
Joy and joy, Jesus Christ was born for this. He has opened heaven's door and man is blessed forevermore. Christ was born for this. Christ was born for this. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice.
Now ye need not fear the grave.
He is peace. Jesus Christ was born to save.
And now, receive the benediction. Friends, God loves you. He came for you, that you might know love, that you might know mercy, that you might know forgiveness, that you might experience his peace. So go out into your world to bring that peace wherever you go and give God the glory. In Jesus' name. Amen.